about what it means for a volume manufacturer like Ford Motor Company. So let's have a look at that. Some of these products you probably recognize, but you may not be aware that they have been electrified in fairly high volumes worldwide. So on the left-hand side, you see a Ford Focus electric, battery electric vehicle. And in the middle, you see a hybrid electric vehicle. It's a Ford Fusion on Mondeo in Europe. And on the right-hand side, you see a Ford C-Max, again, as a hybrid electrified vehicle, or as an what we call an energy vehicle, a plug-in hybrid electrified vehicle. So that Fusion in the middle and the C-Max on the right are both vehicles that use the same powertrain technology, either hybrid or plug-in hybrid. They come with an internal combustion engine and a battery system. And I want to talk a little bit about how we derive requirements for those high voltage subsystems like the battery system. And I think it is fair to say that we believe at this point in time, and I think it was also confirmed from all the speakers before, that there is no single electrification solution that meets every customer requirement. So that means we need to offer a multitude of applications. And let's go and have a look at some of these. Before we go there, just as a reminder, you may not be aware that Ford Motor Company has a number of electrified products, but we have sold since 2005 nearly 500,000 electrified vehicles, hybrids, plug-in hybrids, battery electric vehicles. So I think it's fair to say that we're actually right around the top working on electrified products for our customers. If we talk about customer requirements, we need to talk about attributes. Customers are only interested in attributes, things that they can touch, feel, understand, the characteristics of a vehicle. And I've listed a couple of them that are really relevant for electrified products. Fuel economy, spoke about today already. We're going to talk a little bit about performance as well. You've seen some beautiful products out here that also talk about that, give a message around performance and what electrification can mean for. There's other elements, cargo volume, the trunk volume, the capacity that I have to take my suitcases with me, towing capability in some markets of interest for electrified vehicles as well. And then last but very high on top of most customers' list, electric range. Electric only range is one of the key characteristics, one of the key attributes that our customers are looking for. And the last one is electric charging speed. So how do I provide a charging experience to our customers? And charging speed, how fast can I recharge my battery, but also how convenient is it for me, is another key attribute. So if you look at those, attributes, then one of the points to make there is that for plug-in hybrid vehicles in particular, and for battery electric vehicles as well, the electric range that is being delivered to our vehicles is determined by the size, or the capacity, the energy contents of the battery that I'm installing. And that comes with a certain volume, it comes with a certain weight, and as you can see on the right hand side, it also comes with cost, significant cost. So electric range, we would need to ask our customers to pay for that. If you look at the full hybrid vehicles at the bottom, so these are the non-plug-in hybrid vehicles, their energy capacity is not the key attribute. It's all about the power capability of the battery to deliver performance or to deliver fuel. So what we will see happening on the basis of continuous improvements, customer wants, but also regulatory requirements, is that we need to start improving the fuel economy and the CO2 emissions of our vehicles. It's been spoken about a couple of times already, but I really want to emphasize this. If you look at it on a global scale, typically around 4 to 5% of improvement is required from our fleets on an annual basis. And that is a rate that really outpaces what our capabilities are of improving our internal combustion engines, our traditional technologies that we have in our powertrains. So with those CO2 regulations are becoming more more stringent, and actually having some local requirement, local regulations, like for instance in China, where a vehicle can get a significant tax rebate when it is considered to be an NEV only designated to be an NEV when it has more than 50 kilometers of NEDC driving range. If you look at those specific regulatory requirements, then what you will find is that the size, the capacity of the batteries, the high voltage batteries that we need to install in our vehicles, will be increasing. So you see that line of the plug-in hybrids increasing. And that means cost for us. And it's a good thing that we have improvements, continuous improvements, and they're really going strong on the battery cell side, but also on the battery package, battery design, subsystem design. We're really improving on making them more compact and making them more affordable. But let's talk about that vehicle package. You see a number of examples how individual manufacturers have been trying to implement and trying to integrate such a large battery pack into their vehicles. And it always includes attribute trade-offs. So if you want to put an electric propulsion system into your vehicle, it means I got to place it somewhere. I got to give up something else. And traditionally what we do is we give up the first thing, which is trunk space. Now that going forward is not what our customers actually want. So as you see us progressing, and other automotive manufacturers, you will see that we start maybe not trading off that fifth seat in the vehicle for battery pack and battery range, overall vehicle range, but we start building our vehicles around the battery packs. We start integrating and developing our new vehicle platforms to really be able to contain and to package those larger high voltage batteries. Just an example of the rate of success there. What I show here on the x-axis in this graph is the range, and on the y-axis the cargo capacity change. And this shows for a number of products that are currently on the market how successful manufacturers have been. So if you're at a 100% rate, that means the manufacturer was able to deliver a product that did not give up any cargo space in developing a plug-in hybrid on the left-hand side or a better electric vehicle on the right. Again, different levels of success there at this point in time. Now there's another element which is particularly important for plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, which is the fuel tank size. The battery contains a certain amount of energy that gives it an electric range. Your fuel tank contains an amount of energy that gives us total distance, total range. And one of the interesting things that happened with plug-in hybrid electric vehicles is that it gives you an opportunity to increase the distance between fuel fill-ups. And I think this picture already indicates why that is important for customers. A key element of customer satisfaction is not so much the total range of how far can I go with my vehicle, but in particular for these type of vehicles, how often do I need to go back to the petrol station? And a plug-in hybrid vehicle gives you the opportunity, if it's charged on a regular basis, gives you the opportunity to reduce the amount of times that I need to go back to the petrol station. Just to put some numbers against that here, what you can see is on the horizontal axis, you see the distance between fill-ups in kilometers. This is based on a customer data set that is for proprietary. And you see on the left-hand side on the y-axis the customer percentile. So how do you read this? If you look at the blue line, this is the line that depicts a vehicle, a plug-in hybrid electric vehicle, with a range of about 32 kilometers, which is what we have in our C-MAX plug-in hybrid electric vehicle. And if you look at the blue dot, you see that about 50%, on average, the distance between fill-ups for our C-MAX customers, our plug-in hybrid customers, is more than 1,100 kilometers. So that's quite a distance. And actually, if you creep all the way up in the graph, then what you will see is that there are some customers who hardly ever fill up their vehicle. So these are customers that have fairly short trips during the day, charge up overnight, and they hardly ever see the fuel station. As a matter of fact, we have customer feedback where customers really make that sport, trying never to having to fill up their vehicles with fuel. So more EV range subsequently also means more capability of less fill-up. So if you look at the red line, the green line, and the the orange line, if we increase the EV range of our products, it means customers even less often have to go to the petrol station. Traditionally, hybrid electric vehicles and plug-in hybrids were really focused on delivering fuel economy for the customer. What you see more recently is that a number of products are coming out in the market that are not so much focused on fuel economy, but are more focused on performance. And again, we have some three beautiful examples out here. But you see that a lot of the premium brands are actually moving towards improving the performance of the vehicle. So that's an attribute, that's another attribute important to our customers. And in order to deliver that performance on the vehicle level, my battery system, my electrical system, needs to provide power. So this graph tries to show on a logarithmic scale the time duration that I'm consuming energy from my battery pack, so the power that needs to be delivered by the battery pack. And what you see there is that you have two extremes. On one hand, you have very short, high power boosts that the battery needs to deliver. And on the other hand, you have, over longer periods, you have medium power maybe, but over longer periods, so more energy. That means on the right hand side of this graph you see typical battery electric vehicle operation or plug-in hybrid electric vehicles that are driving electrically only. And on the left hand side you see more support of the electrical system supporting the internal combustion engine, maybe in a more blended mode as we see traditionally with hybrids. Now that has its impact on the battery design, on the battery pack design, and it also has its impact on the battery cell design. And just to give you an example here, on the right hand side you see that the top picture is a cut through of a cell cathode, lithium ion cell cathode, and you see it's thinner. So power cells, batteries developed to deliver power, really have thinner design, thinner electrodes than energy cells. And you can see that, maybe to give an example here, you can see these cell designs. This design is a hybrid prismatic cell, lithium ion cell, using a hybrid product. And the bigger one is also a prismatic cell, lithium ion cell, but it is used in our plug-in hybrid products. Now, hybrids make use of batteries. Plug-in hybrids make use of batteries. Battery electric vehicles make use of batteries. And we operate them in an environment that is not necessarily friendly for the cell chemistry. And you see here the example. Let's have a look at the next page, typically here in the UAE. I think it's fair to say we have a high temperature with varying humidity that has an impact on the AC system of the vehicle. Vehicles operate often after being soaked for a long period of time in the sunlight. So the interior temperature of your vehicle, that's everything, all the mass of the vehicle, from the seats to the body structure and everything, sometimes can reach 70 degrees or higher Celsius temperatures, and therefore needs to be cooled down before the customers would like to operate the vehicle. But at the same point in time, the battery is also impacted by that. So what you will find is that we need to take very much care around how we maintain the batteries in its right operating condition. A little bit helped by the fact that overnight these system vehicle cools down and the battery system itself cools down as well. But as mentioned earlier, there's a big draw on the AC system, and that will not change. So let's have a look at some of the numbers here. I think someone mentioned it yesterday already. Lithium-ion battery cells would like to operate in an environment where we humans feel comfortable as well. As a matter of fact, if you go above 40, 45 degrees Celsius, at that point in time, we really need to start taking down the capability, the power delivery of the battery, just to protect the battery from thermal runaway and from degradation. So what that means is that we need to very carefully manage the temperature of the battery. And if you think about how you cool the system, you always need to have some sort of a temperature difference between the object that you would like to cool and the air that you use or the environment that you can take it from. So if we are operating conditions of about 49 degrees C out there, that means that I'm not going to be able to use that directly to cool my battery. I need to start chilling. I need a heat pump to help to chill the battery and to protect it from becoming damaged and to have it provide its robustness over life. So there's two ways of doing that. So traditionally what we do is we use an air-cooled battery pack for products like hybrid electric vehicles. And then what we do is we chill the air actually by drawing it from the passenger compartment. Again, if I like the air temperature conditions in the cabin, then my battery can use that as well. What I mentioned earlier, however, is that as we progress, we start looking more and more into trying to get the battery, that large battery pack, outside of the cabin area. So as not to have an impact on trunk volume capacity, and so as not to have an impact on the occupancy. So that means we start building systems, that battery systems that actually install the battery under the vehicle. And that means that air cooling is no longer an option, and that means that I need to start moving toward liquid. And that in itself means that I need to start chilling the liquid, because I cannot take the heat, I cannot cool that liquid with a normal radiator in temperatures that happen in this region. So chilling is very, very much important for our battery designs and to maintain robustness. Now if you start looking inside of the battery pack, it also means that I need to take the heat away from the cells themselves. And again, I can do that by flowing air past the cells, which is a fairly straightforward and cost-effective way of doing it. I can put cells on a cold plate where I have through conduction. I make sure that I can cool the cells, or I can even put some individual phases between the individual cells with a liquid cooling again for conduction of heat away from the cell. So depending on how I operate the battery system, more like a full hybrid vehicle with relatively low thermal loading of my batteries, I can get away with using air cooling, chilled air cooling. But if I go for a system that requires more operation from the battery, for instance for a battery electric vehicle or a plug-in hybrid, then typically I start to move towards these conduction-based ways of getting heat out of the battery cells. So just in a high level, Ford is using a power split architecture. Power split architecture means that I have two electric machines that operate with planetary gear. It's a series, parallel, combined system, and it gives me a great opportunity for commonality between full hybrids and plug-in hybrids. So if you look at this, all the blocks in green can make use of the same components. The blue ones are additional components for the plug-in hybrid electric vehicle, or where the system is slightly different. So what I do with the plug-in hybrid electric vehicle, I put in a larger battery pack, add a charger, an onboard charger, to charge that pack, to plug it in, and I make some extension to the cooling system. So with that architecture, we really feel that we're well set up to serve our customers, both on the plug-in hybrid and on the full hybrid side. And that brings me to the end. So to wrap up, what I think I've shown you is that vehicle attributes, along with the operating conditions of the vehicle, really drive the battery requirements. The battery is designed to be robust to operating conditions over the life of the vehicle. That is Ford's approach. And designing a unique battery pack for every individual vehicle is not an option for us. As a large volume manufacturer, we are always focused on commonality. So I would prefer to use a single battery pack in each and every one of my full hybrid electric vehicles. And that's not always possible. So I need to find the right balance between commonality on the one hand and functionality attribute delivery on the other hand. I think I've shown you that Ford has high volume electrified powertrain products in select markets in the US, in Europe, and some other markets since 2005. And we are actively continuing to develop our electrified products to operate in global markets, such as in the region. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Have you got any questions for Daniel at all? Yes, gentlemen in the middle.
Hi, thanks very much for a very interesting presentation. I didn't realize that we need to cool the batteries as well as the passengers in these cars. My name is Ulysses Papadopoulos from Green Emirates. We're trying to encourage companies to go green. So we have a huge demand by Unilever and Procter & Gamble, who've committed and promised to go green in the region. But they're finding it difficult. The dealers here are not interested to import. It's a bit of a chicken and egg situation. How can we break that sooner rather than later?
Yeah, I think we spoke about it yesterday already a little bit. Ultimately, it's about attributes. It's about giving the customer functionality of the vehicle that really makes sense for him or her. I think the from my perspective, key element is make sure that the attribute trade-offs that you are requesting the customer to make are at a minimum or better even provide additional functionality. So I showed the example of performance. Electric machines are great systems to provide a lot of torque at low vehicle speed. So providing driving smoothness, which is an attribute that we haven't really spoken about here today, smoothness and drivability is extremely important when it comes to customer satisfaction of our vehicles. That is an area where the electric drive can really help with. That's another example. So let me give you an example. Our plug-in hybrid vehicles, but actually also our hybrid electric vehicles, make use of an electric AC system. That means I do not need to operate the engine to run the AC system. That means I can chill my vehicle, I can precondition my vehicle without having to start the engine. More so the case for the plug-in hybrid electric vehicle because it has a larger battery pack in it, but even for the hybrid electric vehicle, so I think that it always comes back to those attributes. What do I deliver to the customer and what makes sense for the customer? And I think we maybe should focus a little bit more on those secondary elements than always focus on, oh, it's got better fuel economy or what is good for the environment.
Thank you. And that was actually my question, which is, given that we've sort of heard in previous presentations that customers don't really understand the technology around their cars at all, whether it's the traditional traditionally powered vehicle or electric vehicle, you know, how do we educate the customer about some of the benefits of electric vehicles? And I think picking up the idea of doing it around the sort of capabilities that they look at is possibly the way forward.
Yeah, and this is difficult. It's extremely difficult. We have customers, bring them in the showroom, and we tell them you can have a start-stop vehicle, you can have a hybrid vehicle, you can have a plug-in hybrid vehicle. By the third option that you're offering our customers, typically they're already confused. So it is extremely important that we work together with our dealership, work together with our marketing and sales department, trying to find out what is the right solution for this specific customer. And there are a couple of key questions that you can ask them. There's actually a script that you can develop on this one. And it all centers around what do customers, what attributes do they find important, and how do they operate it? Is it short trips that you're driving? Are you driving every day in the week? Or are you driving during the week in your regular commute and in the weekends you have a longer trip, for instance? Is that important that you have that longer trip today? Or, we spoke about the car sharing schedules earlier today, could I encourage your customer to say, no, you'll have a vehicle that works for you during your commute, but if you want to go for that longer trip, you go for a car sharing opportunity. So communication, I think, has a long road ahead of us and a lot of lessons to be learned. Let's be fair, this is a completely new technology that we're introducing. The market needs to learn it, individual markets need to learn it, individual regions may come with individual demands or feedback about what works well and what does not work well. And we will know in a couple of years.
Any other questions at all?
Okay.
Thank you very much indeed.